Let us worship God, and we're going to sing to his praise in Psalm 67, and you'll find the Psalms at the back of your Bible. Psalm 67, it's the first version of Psalm 67. And it reads, Lord, bless and pity us. Shine on us with thy face, that the earth thy way and nations all may know thy saving grace. Let people praise thee, Lord. Let people all thee praise. Oh, let the nations be glad in songs their voices raise. Though justly people judge, on earth rule nations all. Let people praise thee, Lord. Let them praise thee, both great and small. The earth her fruit shall yield. Our God shall blessing send. God shall us bless. Men shall him fear. Unto earth's utmost end. Lord, bless and pity us. Stand to pray. Eternal and ever blessed one, we pray thine own help as we call on thy name, that we would understand what we are about as we take thy holy name upon our lips and thy word in our hands, lest we dash into thy presence without any thought, without any consideration, that thou art high, high, high above us all, that thou art infinite, that thou art eternal, that thou art unchangeable in thy being, that thou art other from all creation and from all creatures, that thou art so holy that even the heaven of heavens, relatively speaking, is unclean in thy sight. And if thou were to mark our iniquity against us, every one of us, none of us could stand in thy presence here this morning. It's of thy mercies that we are not consumed. Great is thy faithfulness. And we thank thee that thou hast revealed thyself to us, that thou hast revealed thyself to us in a covenant, ratified in the blood of the incarnate Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. A covenant of loving kindnesses and tender mercies. And that thou art saying to us, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, they shall be as wool. We seek thy presence with us as we handle thy word. We seek that thou would bring us under the authority and majesty of thy truth. And we seek particularly thy blessing upon the child who is to be baptized in our midst here this day. Upon her family, as they bring her up in the fear and admonition of thy truth. Upon the congregation, as they too tacitly take vows, unspoken vows, but tacitly take vows that they will remember her in prayer before thee. Upon the minister of the congregation, that he will be enabled to preach in a way that children and middle-aged and elderly will all be able to understand the word of truth and would be enabled to remember in our prayers the children of the congregation as they grow up in our midst. We thank thee for the gift of children. Psalmist could say, lo, children are God's heritage, the womb's fruit his reward. And we covet them, all of them, for thyself. Thou hast said that thou dost desire the heart, and we desire that they would be enabled to surrender their hearts by thy grace to thyself, and that they would come to know thee as the one who governs and rules their lives through thy truth. The word of God is the only rule to direct us how we may glorify thee and enjoy thee. And we seek to enjoy the God of the truth. We pray thy blessing upon this community of thy people here. We pray that thou would pour upon us the spirit of prayer, the spirit of grace, the spirit of supplications and of repentance. We pray that thou would make Christ precious to us in his person, as the only mediator between thee in thy holiness and us in our depravity. Precious to us in his person, precious to us in his finished work, precious to us that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Precious to us in his risenness, triumphant over sin, death, and Satan. Precious to us as the one who makes intercession at thy right hand for his people with great compassion, having experienced all the difficulties of this life himself, and greater than any of us will ever meet. He does not spurn the afflicted's cry. He is still saying in the gospel, come unto me all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We pray that we would know him as the God, the living Savior, the one who will come again at a time in the future we know not when, but who will surely come, and who will come to judge the world. May we be found in that day as those who are his sheep, to whom he will say, come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you before the foundation of the world. And oh, that we would not be found as those who have neglected and rejected his grace. to whom he must then say these sad words, "Depart, ye cursed, and to the place prepared for the devil and his angels." We pray thy blessing upon us together. Open our understanding in thy truth and the truth to our understandings this day. In his precious name we ask it. Amen. And we're going to read the word of truth as we find it in the Old Testament scriptures. The first book of Samuel, 1 Samuel in chapter 1. And we'll read the whole chapter. Now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David was returned from the slaughter. I'm reading the second book of Samuel. Now there was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim of Mount Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephrathite. And he had two wives. The name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, and Hannah had no children. And the man went up out of his city yearly to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. And when the time was that Elkanah offered, he gave to Peninnah his wife and to all her sons and her daughters portions. But unto Hannah he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hannah, but the Lord had shut up her womb. And her adversary also provoked her. That's Peninnah. Peninnah also provoked her, and for to make her fret, because the Lord had shut up her womb. And as he did so year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, so she, Peninnah, provoked Hannah. Therefore she wept and did not eat. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, "Why weepest thou, and why eatest thou not? And why is thy heart grieved? Am not I better to thee than 2 10 sons?" So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord, and she Hannah was in bitterness of soul, and prayed to the Lord and wept sore. And she vowed a vow and said, "O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look upon the affliction of thine handmaid, and remember her, and not forget thine handmaid, but will give unto thine handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head." And it came to pass, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli marked her mouth. Now Hannah, she spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. And so Eli thought she had been drunken. And Eli said to her, "How long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from you." And Hannah answered and said, "No, my lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul unto the Lord. Count not thine handmaid for a daughter of Belial, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. Then Eli answered and said, Go in peace, and the Lord and the God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked of him. And she said, Let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. And they rose up in the morning early and worshipped before the Lord and returned and came to their house to Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. Wherefore it came to pass, when the time was come about, after Hannah had conceived, that she bare a son and called his name Samuel, saying, Because I have asked him of the Lord. And the man Elkanah and all his house went up to offer to the Lord the yearly sacrifice and his vow. But Hannah went not up, for she said unto her husband, I will not go until the child is weaned, and then I will bring him, that he may appear before the Lord, and there abide forever. And Elkanah her husband said to her, Do what seemeth thee good. Tarry until you have weaned him. Only the Lord establishes word. So the woman abode and gave her son suck, and she weaned him. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, with three bottles, with three bullocks, and one ephah of flour, and a bottle of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. And they slew a bullock, and brought the child to Eli. And she said, O my Lord, as thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here, praying to the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord has given me my petition which I asked of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshipped the Lord there. Amen. May the Lord bless to us this reading from his holy word, and may our worship be to his honor and to his glory. And now we're going to sing again, this time in Psalm 121. I to the hills will lift mine eyes, from whence doth come mine aid. Now that's not just the natural hills that the psalmist is speaking of there, the hills of God's sovereign grace. Let's sing the psalm together, the whole psalm. I to the hills will lift mine eyes.
Thank you.
Now, in the portion of scripture that we read a minute ago, you will have noticed in the second last verse of the chapter, the words of Hannah, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord has given me my petition, which I asked of him." She prayed that the Lord would give her a man-child. And the Lord was faithful. He gave her that child. She called his name Samuel. The word Samuel means heard of God. My prayer has been heard. And when she prayed to the Lord, she promised that when she got that child, she would lend him, she would give him to the Lord all the days of his life. Great promise. I want to look at this portion with you today very, very briefly and in the following order. First of all, we'll consider Samuel's father. His name was Elkanah. And then secondly, we'll consider Samuel's mother. Her name was Hannah. And then Samuel's God. And we'll notice there that Samuel was God's man for the hour. These three strands of thought, fairly briefly then this morning. First, Samuel's father, Elkanah. Well, you'll have noticed, as we read, he was a man who had two wives. Two wives. Hannah and Peninnah. Probably, we don't know, but probably that had come about because his first wife, Hannah, did not bear any children. And he became impatient so that he could have more children. He could have children, so he married Peninnah. But two wives. Notice that impatience is a sin. It's calling in question God's providence. Certainly not an act of faith. And look also what happened. Two wives is not in accordance with God's plan for us. He gave us the first marriage himself in the Garden of Eden. One man, one woman. Adam and Eve. And that's to be the pattern throughout the generations. Not one man and two wives, but one man and one wife. And when we follow that pattern, it's good for society. That's a building block of society, marriage, and the children that issue from marriage. Brought up in the fear and admonition of the Lord, and you get an ordered society, not the mishmash of confusion and riots that we have today when we have gone away from the Lord's plan and when people are thinking of man and a man marrying or a woman and a woman marrying. That's not in accordance with God's plan. That's sinful and is leading to confusion and disorder in our land. But God's plan is for one man and one woman. Well, that was wrong in the household here. Notice also about Elkanah. He tried to have one foot in the church and he tried to have one foot in the world. One foot in the world, as we've just seen, going along with a pattern of marriage that the Lord had not sanctioned. And one foot in the church because he kept going to the church yearly to the tabernacle, national tabernacle at Shiloh at that time, and offering sacrifices. Well, you can't worship God and Mammon. God says, give me your heart. Not part of it, but all of it. We notice that this disobedience to God in the way that his marriage was formed with one man and two wives led to division in the home. We notice as we read that Hannah and Peninnah quarreled a lot. Peninnah particularly provoking Hannah because she had no children. and it led to division in the home. Sin always does that. Elkanah is not really a good example for us to follow, but there was Hannah's father, Samuel's father. And then secondly, Samuel's mother, Hannah. Hannah, I think, means grace, if I remember rightly. She was a woman with a heavy heart. And we know what caused the grief to her, the heaviness of heart to her, the fact that she had no children. Not that that in itself should cause grief. You find that runs through the Bible, women without children. At the beginning, anyway, Abraham's wife Sarah, she was into her 80s before she had a child. Long, long time. Samson's mother, long time without a child as well. And John the Baptist's mother, Elizabeth, long time again before she had a child. But in the Old Testament, if a woman didn't have a child, it was considered a disgrace to her. And that was a bit of grief to her, that she had no children. We're told the Lord had shut up her womb. Well, that just means that a womb was not open to children being born by her at that time. But not only was she a woman who had a heavy heart, a grievous spirit, she was a godly woman, a godly woman. And you noticed when she went up to Shiloh, in a portion that what we've been reading, went up to the national temple, the yearly visit there, she went into a room on her own and she poured out her heart to the Lord. That's the way godly people pray. It's not just a matter of words. Oh, words, yes, but it comes to the heart. Her prayer, pouring out her heart to the Lord. And the Lord heard her. The Lord heard her. Eli, the priest, the high priest, he noticed her. He noticed her sitting on there on her knees on her own, her mouth open, but she wasn't hearing any words. He concluded she was drunk. He was wrong. She was pouring out her heart to the Lord. And when he understood it, he said, "Oh, may the Lord give you what you have asked." She went home, and soon she conceived and bore this child, and she called his name Samuel, "Heard of the Lord. My prayer has been heard." And you remember that in her prayer, and this shows her godliness as well, she had promised the Lord that that child would be given to him, lent to him, all the days of his life. And she honored that vow. When she kept the child until it was weaned, and in those days it would take three years maybe before the child stopped having suck from his mother. But probably at the age of three, she took that child up to the temple. She met Eli, the high priest, and she said, "You heard me praying. You thought I was drunk 3 years ago. Well, for this child I prayed." Oh, what a wonderful thing when we can say, "For this child I prayed. And now I have promised the Lord that I would give him to him." And she left the child with Eli there to be brought up in the knowledge of the Lord. No doubt she remembered him. No doubt she knitted socks for him. No doubt she made little coats for him and brought it to him on occasions. But she gave him to the Lord. How important that we give our children to the Lord. And I mean that in the sense of that we bring them up in the knowledge of the Bible, of his own word, that we bring them to church, that we set a godly example before them in the home, and that we bring them to Sunday school in due course. How important that these children should have be remembered by the congregation in their prayers and in their example. How important that these children should be remembered by the minister when he preaches, so that they would preach out, they would understand what he's saying. How important that it should come to know the Bible, that they should come to know God, and in due course, and this is the purpose of baptism today, little bit of water that will sprinkle on the child's, on Evelyn's head, on her forehead. That little water, it's pointing to a washing that the child needs, that we all need. Not just a washing with our hands, but a washing of our souls. What the Bible calls the washing of regeneration, the washing of rebirth, of being born again, and of coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ as our own Savior. That's the real purpose of the baptism today. But that is how we give our children to the Lord. Bring them up to worship him, to know him, and to enjoy him. It's not a boring thing. It's a wonderful, the most greatest privilege you can know in this world, to be a Christian and to know the Lord as your God and your Savior and your friend and your keeper. For this child I prayed, and she gave that child to the Lord. Just a word more than Samuel, God's man for the hour. The time that Samuel was born was a time of great spiritual darkness in Israel. It was the time of the judges. And the period of the judges lasted up some 400 years. And it was, as I said, a time of spiritual declension, as bad as it is in our own country today. Every man did what was right in his own sight. Well, God had a plan. God was going to bring about a change. And it's amazing that change began God's working in the heart of this woman. This woman, this domestic situation, this woman, Hannah. The soreness of heart, the fact that she had no child, bringing her, well, the Spirit of the Lord helping her, but bringing her through the instrumentality of that grief to come in prayer, to pray for the Lord, that the Lord would give her, in his mercy, a child. That was the beginning of God's working. And then you get God's working in the putting into her heart that he would give that, she would give that child to the Lord. She would bring him up to be for the Lord. And she did. And then you see the plan also. The priests that were there in the church at that time were absolutely corrupt. The two men called Hophni and Phinehas, and they were bad men. They were a disgrace. They were a disgrace to the ministry. And the Lord was going to take them away. They both of them went away. They were slain in battle in one day. The Lord was going to replace them in due course with this child, Samuel. And even Eli, the high priest, he was a good man, but he was careless. He was careless in the sense that he wasn't disciplining his sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And in due course, he was taken away as well. And the child Samuel grew up, and as he grew up, he became, well, what we would call today a minister of religion. And for 20 years, he preached the gospel
going up and down the land of Israel. Nothing seemed to be happening. Didn't seem as if God was doing anything. But soon it became pleasant, aware God was doing something. Revival broke out. But it came through the instrumentality of this child, Samuel. God's plan for the hour. May the Lord raise up in our own day a praying woman like Hannah. May he raise up a child of God, a child who was brought up in God's holy admonition, like Samuel was. May he become a preacher whose preaching would be blessed to the whole nation. God can turn a nation in one day and bring about revival in our land. We need it so greatly. Samuel, God's man for the hour. Well, may the Lord bless to us these few thoughts. Let us again well, just a few words on baptism itself. Not just a few words, you probably heard me speaking most of them already. Baptism, the baptism you see today is a child, Evelyn, being publicly and formally admitted into adherent membership of the church. Not a communicant member. Baptism does not convert her, but it's a formal admission of becoming an adherent of the church. And that being an adherent brings her into great privileges, the privilege of the father and mother promising that they will bring her up in the knowledge and admonition of the truth. They'll have family worship, and they will seek to set a godly example before her. The privilege of being brought to the church when she's old enough, coming to Sabbath school, being brought up to know memory verses in the Bible. Great privileges these are. Privilege of the discipline of the church. You find very often that children who have been brought up, have been baptized into the church, and when they come to the age of 13, 14, oh, they begin to become a wee bit rebellious, and away they go, prodigals, away from the church. Well, it's the responsibility of the church then to speak to the parents and to speak to the child itself, the danger that she's putting, that they're putting their soul into by going away from the word of truth and from the God of truth and the God of mercy. Discipline in that sense. Privileges and responsibilities that are there as being part of the visible church. That's the first part of the meaning of baptism. Admission, formal admission. She became a covenant child from the time of birth, but here it is, public admission into the visible church. Well, there's more. There's this little splashing of a few drops of water on her forehead and the vows that are taken. You'll see these later. And they're pointing out to a wash, I've already spoken of it, a washing not just of the hands, a washing of our soul. We all of us are sinners, and we need that washing of the soul. Washing of regen, washing of being born again. Washing of coming to know Christ as my Savior. Washing where we put our soul's welfare into the hands of the living Christ, and we experience the forgiveness, the sweet persuasion of sin forgiven, and being on course through this life, ultimately through death itself, which becomes a stepping stone from one existence to a glorious new life and into glory. and indeed continuing in glory, because the Bible tells us that his people will be brought from fountain of living waters to fountain of living waters eternally in the glory. Oh, what sweet mercies are laid up there for us. The baptism speaks of what we desire for that child, that she would come in due course in the Lord's time, that the being brought up in the word of the truth would be blessed to her, and she would come to know Christ as her Saviour and her God. Baptism. Now I'm going to come down and I'll ask Peter and Cathel and Evelyn to come forward to here, to appear, please, and I'll come down there. Stand for praying, and after the prayer we're going to have the, well, first of all, please sit down. I'm going to read first of all our warrant for fulfilling what we are doing here today. Nothing that we do in the church, but we must have a warrant from the Bible for it. And the warrant for the baptism comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, and chapter 28, and from verse 16. Excuse me, I'm not 20/20 vision, but I'll read what we have here. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed for them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." And these words particularly: "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Amen. That's our warrant for performing this act of baptism here today. A warrant from the Bible. A short prayer and we'll stand. And after we stand, after we've prayed, remain standing, and I'll put the vows to Peter, who will answer them as the head of the household for the whole family. Let us pray first of all. We pray for this family, that as it was with Hannah, who lent her child to the Lord all the days of his life, that this ch- child Evelyn would be lent also to the Lord in the sense that she would grow up to know the word of truth, that she would come to know her need as a sinner, that she would come to know the provision that God has made, the giving of his own son, for the salvation of lost souls. Come to realize the wonder that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Come to know the wonder of the person of Christ as the one who is God and man in two distinct natures. The wonder that the child Jesus was the one who was giving life to his mother Hannah, to his mother Mary, even when she was cradling him in his infancy, even when he was dependent upon her from for the milk that she provided from her own body. He was the one as God who was giving life to her. For he is God and man in two distinct natures. But even on Calvary's cross, he was the one who sustained the nails that nailed him to that cross. He could have shriveled these nails to bits. He could have called on a host of angels to deliver him. But such was his love that he gave himself to bear the curse that ought to be ours in our Roman place. So that when we put our trust in him as the one who has done all in our Roman place, God looks upon us in Christ and acquits us of guilt, and indeed having title in him to eternal reward. Oh, make him precious to us. We pray thy blessing then on all that we do, on the vows that are to be taken, the baptism that is to be performed, all to be done with trust to thine honour and to thy glory. Amen. And now that are these vows, Peter, do you believe the scriptures of the Old Testament and the New Testament to be the word of God and the only rule of faith and life?
We do.
Do you believe in God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three persons, one God, as taught in the Holy Scriptures and confessed by this branch of the visible church?
We do.
Do you confess your repentance from your sins and your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
We do.
Do you promise the Lord shall enable you to bring up Evelyn in the knowledge, Evelyn Ruth, I should say, to bring up Evelyn Ruth in the knowledge of the Christian faith and the nurture and admonition of the Lord? And do you also therefore promise to strive after godliness in your home and in public? And do you therefore now place Evelyn Ruth under the spiritual care of Christ's church?
We will.
Evelyn Ruth, I baptize you in the name of the Holy, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you and give you to be washed clean.
like to call on Granda, Mr. Duncan McSwin, Elder, Scalpe Free Church, grandfather to Evelyn, to lead us in prayer. We'll remain seated, but Duncan, please.
We thank thee again for thy goodness to us, for thy mercies, and for thy compassions, and for thy forgiveness, and for all that thou art in thyself, that thou art our God, our Father in heaven, the one who created us in thine own image, so that we would worship thee. And we thank thee for each and every gift that thou hast given. And as we hear, we thank thee for the gift of children, and how precious they are. And it is the desire of thy own people that each of them would grow up to be thy own in their young and tender years. And we pray this day, Lord, that thou wouldst bless the little ones. Pray, Lord, that they would grow up to be thy own in their young years. That they would grow up, Lord, like Samuel, that they would repent to the Lord, and that they would serve thee all the days of their life. We thank thee, Lord, that thou art the one who watches over us as families. And we thank thee, Lord, that thou art the one who provides for us each and every day. Even this day itself, we are conscious, Lord, that thou art the one who has given us our health and our strength and our daily bread and all the many blessings which we receive. We thank thee, Lord, for every good and perfect gift. We thank the Lord for the greatest gift of all, thy only begotten Son, that we have been hearing about this day, who came from heaven's glory to us in written earth, to suffer and to die for sinners such as we are. We thank thee that he came. We thank thee, Lord, that he declared on the cross for the sinners, the sacrifice was complete. We thank the Lord for the empty tomb that he is risen. And we thank thee that for the hope that we have, that he is coming again soon. So we pray, Lord, that thou wouldst bless us. Bless us as individuals and bless us as families. Bless us in our family here this day. We thank thee, Lord, for the little ones here today. We pray, Lord, that they will grow, that to be thine own and thine own life. Thank thee, Lord, that remember, Lord, thy servant who preached here for many years, and who has now been taken away to be with thyself. And we thank the Lord for the many times he has preached to the little ones here and before their sins, and how we loved him. We pray, Lord, that these words will be blessed in the days and the months and the years to come. And we will see a young generation rising up to honor thee and serve thee, not only here but throughout this land of ours, that we will see a generation that would be shining lights in this great world. Young ones growing up to worship thee and to serve thee. So bless us, Lord, and bless Peter and Cathel, and give them, Lord, as with other parents, give them, Lord, wisdom and all that is required to raise up the little ones, which is a great discussion. That thou wouldst bless them, Lord, and lead them on with thyself. And which over us will be the name of the Lord, and bless thy servant who gave us this day, we thank thee, Lord, that thou wouldst afford him and sustain him in these days. Thank thee, Lord, for all we hear from him from time to time. Bless thy word this day throughout the end of the year, that thy great name will be glorified this day and all that is
Thank you, Duncan. Now, I missed out a psalm, but we're not going to be outdone. We're going to have Psalm 23, which you all know, the Lord's my shepherd. And then we're going to have the psalm that was got its place here, Psalm 100, all people that on earth do dwell, Psalm 23 first, and Psalm 100 afterwards, in that order.
Now we're going to have Psalm 100, All People That On Earth Do Dwell, Sing to the Lord with Cheerful Voice. These are the intimations, and they're all subject to the will of God. A warm welcome to our service today. A bit late, but a warm welcome nevertheless. And the evening service will be here in Port Mahomock at 6:30. Worship next Lord's Day is in Port Mahomock at 12 noon and in Inver at 6:30 p.m. And the expected preacher next Sunday is the Reverend David Ratti. The midweek prayer meeting is at 7:30 p.m. on Wednesday, held via Zoom. Details of how to connect into the meeting, either online or via telephone, are available at the church door. Sunday school and Bible class recommence on next Lord's Day, meeting at 11 o'clock in the morning in the church vestry. So anyone who wants to send his children to Sabbath school with us, most welcome. And the induction of the Reverend Murdo McKeever to the West Hill Congregation of Inverness is to be held at 7 p.m. on the 30th of August, Friday the 30th of August, at the Dramosi Hotel. And we're going to conclude with the benediction. And after the benediction, I'm going to ask Peter, Cathell, and the family to go to the door, please, and meet the people as they come out. Let us stand to hear the Lord's benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, rest on and remain with you. Amen.